All right, welcome. Good morning, everyone. Welcome. If you are here for Advancing Leadership for Health Equity, then you are in the right place. And Happy New Year. This is a Community Health Training Institute free training on advancing leadership for health equity. So I'll hand it over to our trainers in just a moment. First, I wanted to just welcome you all. If it's your first CHTI training or you've been to all of our trainings, welcome back. My name is Lauren Bard. I am a senior training manager here at Health Resources in Action. And the Community Health Training Institute is funded in partnership by HRIA and the Massachusetts Department of Public Health. So that funding allows us to offer these free trainings all year round. This is our first training of the new year. You can learn more about CHTI and the rest of our free trainings by going to our website, hriainstitute.org. On that website is where you can also find the only coalition roster for the Commonwealth of Massachusetts. So if you are representing a coalition or a leader of a coalition, we ask that you update or enter your information. If you're already on there, please update your information. And that's also where you can sign up for our newsletter, which you may already receive because you found out about this training. But if you don't, then you can scroll down to the bottom of that page and get our newsletter, which is always full of information and resources and advertisements about our future trainings. So before I hand it over to Val and Erica, I just want to ask other members of the CHTI team to introduce themselves. So I see our friend Tanayo is here.
Hello, yes. Good morning, everyone. My name is Tanayo Crow. I go by she, her pronouns. I'm a program associate with the Community Health Training Institute. I've been here for about 4.5 years, which is crazy. I'm really excited to be here with you all this morning. I'm just kind of here in the background supporting Eli with the tech work today. But if you have any questions, feel free to just shoot me a message and I will pass it to Eli.
Thank you. Excuse me. Thank you, Tanayo. Good morning, everyone. My name is Eli Adler Cohen. I use he, him, his pronouns, and I am an administrative coordinator here on the Community Health Training Institute team. Super excited to be here. And I'm going to be doing tech support for folks today. So if anyone is running into any Zoom problems or has any questions, feel free to just send me a message via the chat and happy to kind of assist. And we're going to be going over some other Zoom logistics shortly after our trainers give themselves a little introduction. So yeah, happy to be here and welcome.
All right, thank you. With that, let me turn it over to Val and Erica.
I think that Eli was going to walk through some of the Zoom tech before we pick us off, if you're able to do that, Eli.
Yes, totally can. Let me share my screen real quick just to make sure that we are all in the right place. Give me 1 second. Sorry about that. Cool. So just going to go over a quick amount of tech stuff. So if you're looking here, this is kind of your Zoom screen that you have in front of you. And I'm sure many folks here are familiar with Zoom, but if not, no problem at all. So kind of on the bottom left of your screen, over in this lower red box, you have your mute and stop video function. If at any point you want to kind of mute or unmute yourself, you can just click that little microphone icon in the corner. And that will kind of turn your microphone on or off. And then likewise, right to the right of it, if you want to turn your camera on or off, if you need to kind of run and grab some more coffee and you want to turn it off, or if you want to turn it on for a breakout room, you can just kind of click that little camera function and that will kind of turn your camera on or off. Over kind of in the middle of your screen, there's a participants little icon. It's a person. And if you want to change your name, you can kind of go and find yourself. It should be on the top of the participants list, and you can go change your name, add whatever information you like. And then right to the right of that, you have this chat function. So throughout the day, we're gonna be kind of using the chat function. It's a way to add comments to the training, or if you have any questions and you don't wanna interrupt the trainers or someone else talking, you can just put that in the chat and it will go to everyone. So that way, if you wanna kind of add a comment again, you can without disrupting things. Over on the top right of your screen, there's a little icon that says speaker view or gallery view, and that will kind of dictate what's showing up on your screen. So if you want to see all people in the training, you can click gallery view, and that will kind of show everyone on screen in various boxes. But if you just want to be looking at the speaker, you can then click on that and change it to speaker view, and that way you'll just see the person talking at that time. Not sure if we're going to be using the annotate function today at all, but if you kind of go to the top of your screen and you click on that view options, sometimes in trainings we'll have kind of a blank screen, and if you click the annotate function, you'll be able to kind of write in on the Zoom screen itself a picture or a comment. I think if we get there, I can assist again. Not sure if we're getting there, but that's all of the basic functions. Again, if anyone has any questions or is running into any trouble, please feel free to reach out. I'll pass it back over to the trainers.
Thanks, Eli. We can go to slide six. I think we just wanted to intro ourselves. While I'm doing that, feel free to, we're going to break up into small groups. You all can get to know each other in a little bit. But in the meantime, feel free to enter in the chat just where you are joining us from, just to get a sense of who is in the room and where you're joining us from. And then we'll do some small group breakouts to get to know each other a little bit better. We will be doing some breakout rooms today, actually quite a few, so you all have a chance to exchange experiences and ideas with each other. So stay tuned for that. You'll get a countdown message when you have about a minute left. I'm always taken by surprise when those pop up. and then you'll see a button in there to leave the breakout room if you do need to leave at any time. All right, so with that, I think there's something about if anyone's joining by phone. So you can see here that there's a call-in number and participant ID if you need to join us by phone. If you're having any Zoom tech issues, which I've been having this morning, so maybe I'll be joining you by phone in a little bit. All right, so a little bit about us. We are really excited to be here with you this morning, and thank you to the CHTI training team for inviting us to speak with you. My name is Valerie Poletta, she, her pronouns. I am with Health Resources in Action. I'm a managing director of community and culture transformation. What does that mean? I lead a team within our organization to focus on transforming our culture and centering equity in our policies and our practices, making sure that we are walking our talk, as we also do work externally in the community to center equity in our policies and practices. And then also a little bit about myself. Personally, I identify as Latina and white. I'm the daughter of immigrants who are Colombian and Italian. I'm also a first generation college graduate, and we wanted to bring some of our identities into this space, especially considering how we'll be talking about lived experience today. And, you know, I carry those identities with me every day in the work that I do at HRA, and it definitely informs and influences how I approach my work. So wanted to share a little bit about myself as a human too. And with that, I'll pass it over to Erica.
Thanks, Valerie. And it's so nice to see all of you this morning. My name is Erica Gaitan. I serve as the Senior Manager of Community Impact at Health Resources in Action. And in that role, I really support our partners to develop, implement really a lot of methods to increase community power so that residents, community groups, coalitions can have more of that power in the neighborhood, municipal, and state level decision making. I've been at the organization for about 8 years, and a little bit more about me personally. I'm a social worker. Prior to my work at HRIA, I strongly identify as a youth worker. I worked at Zoomix in East Boston, which is a music nonprofit, and was also a fourth grade teacher. So I've had a lot of different roles throughout my life. And just a little bit about my identities and what I bring into this space. I also identify as Latina. I'm Mexican American. I'm a queer person, a Southerner. I was born and raised in deep South Texas. So I grew up on the border in a place called the Rio Grande Valley. And I have a long history of farm workers in my family. And so that's a lot of the identities that I bring forth in this work and how I identify. So really good to be here with y'all.
Thanks, Erica. And we look forward to getting to know all of you a little bit better. Thanks for sharing where you're joining us from. Again, we'll do small group breakouts in a moment. I'm joining you from Dorchester, Massachusetts. So with that, let's dive into sort of what we're hoping to get into today. These are our learning objectives. So as I mentioned, we want to focus on elevating the value of lived experience in navigating systems of oppression. We'll be sharing some strategies with you on how to build community power within your organization or the communities that you are working in. And then last but not least, we are planning to share a couple of tools with you and also give some time to apply those tools as well. And so the next slide shows you.
Worcester. Turn on your heat. I didn't know.
And so a little bit about our journey, our roadmap for today. We, on the next slide, you can see we are going through welcome and introductions. Eli, I don't know if my screen is frozen. There we go. we want to do some level setting with you all and talk about what we mean by power and how power can be leveraged. And then we're planning to share with you some examples, both internally within our own organization at HRIA and also externally with the communities that we work with. And then, as I mentioned, at the end, we'll have some time to have you all practice or try on some of the concepts and tools that we'll be sharing with you today. And so with that, we're going to get into building some community here in our Zoom space today. We're going to have you go into small groups of about 4 to 5 people. So you all will have some time to share your name, your pronouns, if you wish, what you do, and then just what has been the highlight of your week so far. And so with that, Eli, whenever you're ready, you can send us off into small groups. Thanks. See you all in about 10 minutes. Okay, welcome back, everyone. I hope you had some time to get to know each other a little bit. And as I mentioned, throughout this, our time together, there will be other opportunities for small groups to continue your conversations. So the other piece we want to cover before we dive into the content is around group agreements to build a container for our space today. So we've put down a handful of group agreements for you all to consider that we wanted to offer. I'm not going to go through all of these, but some of the ones I will lift up is, you know, to the extent possible, be present and engaged. I recognize that can be challenging in the Zoom work world. If you're someone who often speaks up, think about maybe making space for others. And if you're someone who maybe doesn't often speak up, we encourage you to take space as well. We are going to be sharing some ideas today, some of which may be new, some of which may be familiar. We also want to hear about your experiences and your ideas. So really encourage everyone to be open and work through these concepts together and lean into your vulnerability. bringing our collective hearts into this space, encourage you to speak and listen from the heart. And then to the extent you are comfortable and able to bring your full selves and your identities. I would love to hear, so those are a few I wanted to lift up. Any additions though to these group agreements as we spend time together in this space for the next couple of hours. Anything you see missing that you want to offer? No.
I like the be aware of intention, take care of impact. And I'm trying to think of like exactly what that would look like, but I like it.
Yeah, I appreciate you lifting that up, Heather. I think, you know, what I would consider is like, as someone who may be sharing an idea or an opinion, you may have an intention, but be aware of how it might impact others. Thank you for lifting that one up. Any other additions or questions?
On kind of a similar note, I like the leave the details, take the message. So if you're engaging with folks and someone's giving kind of a personal anecdote, I think it's really important to kind of respect the privacy of those people and not necessarily take all of the details out back into your other parts of your life, but instead like try to just focus on the message of the story. So that way you're kind of respecting people's privacy as well as kind of getting an understanding of their story and what the takeaways were.
I appreciate that, Eli. Another is, I think one that I've heard that's similar is what's heard stays and what's learned leaves, which sounds similar to what you were offering. I added that to the slide. Great. Other additions or questions before we move forward? Oh, I like that too. Take the learnings, leave the stories. These are all great variations. Nice. Thanks, Ashley. Okay, well, I'm going to ask if you all are in agreement that, you know, as we spend our time together, we will keep these in mind as we share space. I'm going to ask for a thumbs up, or if you want to do a stretch break, let me know that you are in support of these. This stretch feels good, so I'm going to keep going. Or you can use an emoji if you're off camera. I'm seeing people in support. Awesome. Thank you. All right. Last but not least, this next slide, we want to do some level setting, recognizing that we are bringing some terms and words into this space. Want to ensure that we have a shared understanding of the language we are using. So the two that I'm highlighting right now are policies and practices. What do we mean as we move forward in our training and talk about policies and practices? And so if I could actually ask for a volunteer to read the slide, who would like to?
I can take it.
Thank you.
Policies are the government, institutional, and organizational rules, regulations, and priorities that guide an entity's own and others' actions to establish and change systems. Practices are the procedures, guidelines, and informal shared habits that comprise our work to support and change those systems.
Great. Thank you so much, Carla. So I think what I want to emphasize here is because I think often when people hear the word policy, they might think solely of governmental policy change. And that's one aspect of it. But today we're also going to be talking about organizational policy change too. And that it's important to hold both policies and practices together because they can reinforce one another. So another point that I want to lift up is that you could have a really strong policy in writing at your organization, but that doesn't mean that people are practicing it or implementing it. And vice versa, you could have something that is practiced by some staff within the organization, but it's not practiced consistently across the organization, and having a written policy could help reinforce that. So thinking about how policy and practice can be mutually reinforcing. The other two terms that we'll be sharing definitions for today in a little bit are around power and community power building, as well as lived experience. So stay tuned
we'll be offering some definitions around that language as well. And with that, I'm going to pass it to my colleague, Erica, to talk about what's power got to do with it.
Thank you, Valerie. And thanks, everyone, for your engagement so far. Before diving into the lived experience pieces and really getting leadership buy-in and those other rich conversations we're going to have, we would be remiss if we didn't talk about power. Because we know that power operates everywhere. It's embedded in all of our relationships within our organizations and our org charts, and even in our personal lives. So we wanted to take this first piece to really think about power, how it's operating in our work, and how it really influences our pieces as we're thinking about lived experience, buy-in, and cultivating influence and interest. I think the key takeaway here as we're thinking about power is that in order to permanently change those conditions and communities that are experiencing oppression, we really need to build collective power to create that long-term systemic change. So we need that systemic way of understanding power, how it influences within ourselves, within our roles, and within our systems to start making change within our communities. So we're going to go through a couple of definitions, but I'm really curious, what comes to mind when you hear or think about power? So I'm going to ask folks if they can in the chat, maybe drop the first 1 to 2 words that come to mind when you think about power. So we'll see what starts coming in. Money, control, imbalance, status quo, decision-making, disparity, resources. Absolutely. Voice, white male money, misused.
He's not here today. He's sick.
Oh, he's okay. That's what I thought.
White supremacy culture. Yeah, thank you all. I think these are a lot of the things that we hear in our work too, and recognizing that power has so many different meanings. Sometimes it's about those people and actors. Other times it's about those structures, rules, and institutions. And sometimes it's about how we feel within our roles and capabilities to act for or against change. And then a lot of times what I saw come up in the chat was material resources, right? Money and the power to affect actions. And then sometimes located in our very intimate experiences within our families or private lives. So thank you all, seniority, agency. Thank you all for these definitions. So we're gonna move forward to see how we're defining power for the purpose of our discussion today. And I'm gonna ask if one person can volunteer to read that top quote by Dr. Martin Luther King.
I could do it.
Thank you. Thanks, Sharon.
Power, properly understood, is nothing but ability to achieve purpose. It is the strength required to bring about social, political, and economic change.
Thank you, Sharon. So we'll be using this definition used by Dr. Martin Luther King. There are a ton of definitions of power out there, but what we wanted to bring forth is that power is dynamic and it's not static. So this second quote by our colleagues in a publication called Making Change Happen, they say power is dynamic, relational, and multidimensional, changing according to its context, circumstance, and interest. Its expressions and forms can range from dominance to resistance to collaboration and transformation. So when thinking about Dr. King's definition of really the ability to achieve purpose and knowing within ourselves that power is dynamic, it's not static. And sometimes we have these assumptions of who wields power in our communities and how powerless we feel a lot of these times. So we're going to be thinking about that powerless feeling and trying to spend some time really recognizing the power within ourselves, because we know that collective power is the sum of each one of our individual powers coming into the space. And so we're going to take some time to reflect on that in the next activity. In the next slide. Just quickly, a lot of the definitions I saw in the chat were examples of when we think of power as power over folks. And that really is the power that folks use to fear, hoard, and protect power. maintain the status quo, and it really is finite. And we're trying to shift that framing to think of a power with approach. So Brené Brown talks a lot about this, that when power is shared, it is infinite. It can expand and it can be shared with others. So we wanted to bring those two things up, the power over and power with, that we really want to focus a power with approach in our changes in our communities and how we're thinking about it in our work. Again, power affects everything we do. And understanding that power that prevents change from happening, as well as understanding the power we have within ourselves to create change, will really push us to that more just, sustainable, and positive future. So to start thinking about what is it that we bring into this space, we wanted to share a tool, and this power wheel comes from our colleagues at Equity and Results, who do the wonderful training on anti-racist results-based accountability online. So check that out if you're interested. But this power wheel is just an example of different kinds of power that we wield within our own lives as individuals. So starting at that yellow quadrant up at the right-hand top, when we say power, that can be cultural power, or what is your heritage, the resilience or cultural assets that you bring into this space. It can be people power. Who do you relate to? Who do you know? Who do you network through? Political power is kind of that formal authority that you bring into this space, policymaking power, or your role within your organization. And then we have economic power, which I saw a lot of folks drop in the chat, the money piece, those material resources that you bring and you wield to your life. And then your inner power, and that's your know-how, the skills, the energy you bring in, your subject matter expertise to personally affect change, and other types of power that may not be on this wheel. But we did want to provide some examples as you start brainstorming, because oftentimes we can think about this hierarchical power and not spend time reflecting on all of the power that's in this space. So we're gonna spend some time taking an inventory of the power that we bring. We're gonna spend some time in reflection so that you can journal a little bit and then share with your peers kind of what are the powers that you bring? What are your superpowers? Where do you feel most powerful? So I can give you an example of that. So again, my name is Erica Gaitan. My cultural powers, I'm bilingual and bicultural. My people power, I'm a social worker. And so I have a strong network of social workers on the front line doing the work and really have a pulse of that community. Within my organization, I'm a senior manager. And so I do have the ability to have some power over budgets and staffing for certain projects that I lead. And that's really that formal authority. My inner power, I would say that I'm a good listener. I try to have positive vibes, positive energy in the space. And my subject matter expertise is really in the field of research and evaluation, as long as community organizing. So that's some of the things that I think are my superpowers. And I would love to hear what your superpowers are. And so this next activity, Eli, if you go into this next slide, we're gonna spend the next bit of time reflecting on this power wheel. You're gonna spend 5 minutes doing some individual reflection, taking note in an inventory, and they don't have to be a part of that wheel. We just wanted to lift up some examples. And this is something we encourage you to use with your teams too, especially for folks working with those at the front lines, those with lived experience of oppression, who are really feeling the burden of all the weights of the status quo, and reminding folks and taking note that we do have power within ourselves. So we'll spend 5 minutes reflecting, then we'll go into small breakout groups to kind of share with your colleagues, and then come back for a large group discussion. So the prompts will be on the next slide. Eli, if you can go to that next one. This is the wheel, but it's just in narrative format in case you need a quick reference. And when we come back to the space, I want you to talk a little bit about when and where do you feel most powerful. So that can be a space, a time, a location, and also what did this exercise bring up for you? So talk about it amongst your peers after you've done some reflection, really hear whose superpowers, what are they in the space, And then we'll all come back as a group to really debrief and say, what did this bring up for you in this exercise? So Eli, with that, I'm going to pitch it to you so we can do 5 minutes of reflections. Sammy, that's a great question. Could resilience also be part of other segments? Absolutely. Valerie, I saw your suggestion, economic power, for example, and I think a lot of these can overlap in several different buckets. But again, we wanted a quick visual, a prompt to be able to say, well, maybe these will fit into these, but we encourage you to adapt the visual and the activities as you see fit with the ultimate goal of reflecting on the powers that be within us. Thanks for the heads up, Rosie. Okay, Eli, you want to give us 5 minutes? Feel free to turn off your cameras. Take some time to think for yourselves. I know as an introvert, it's always helpful for me to reflect silently for a bit. So we'll do that next.
Yes, and according to my clock, I think we'll be back around 10:52-ish.
As well as understanding the power we have within ourselves and with others to create change, which hopefully will lead us towards a more just, sustainable, and positive future. In order to do that, we need to be explicit in naming our powers so that we can start thinking about shifting them and working towards our collective power, which we're going to start talking about next. But before doing that, I would love to just open it up and hear from a couple of folks, either some of the powers that you talked about in your group, or what that activity brought up for you as you were thinking through it.
For our group, quite a few of us had still an issue with the word power, like we still have some tension around that. Many of us felt like we had less power in the role of what we serve at work. We do periodically at times, but where we consistently feel like we have power is at home. Mm. As a parent or as someone that can, I don't want to say rule over children, but essentially just that parent role and those responsibilities. And to be honest, even if you have children or not, but I would say that that was like a big trend with our group.
Yeah, thanks Hope for sharing that. And you bring up a great point about how our identities shift and change. And within each of those identities, we wield different kinds of power. And so to be able to reflect on those spaces of what does our 9-to-5 look like? What does post-work look like is a really important one. So thanks for lifting that up. Anyone else? What did this exercise bring up for you? Any big themes?
I was thinking, you want to go ahead?
Go ahead, Lisa.
Oh, okay. I just, when I think about power, I think about privilege, which is sort of, you know, like the different ways we have power might be just because we're born in a certain way with certain identities. But then there's other ways that maybe you've gained power because you have skills. And so it, to me, that's sort of, when I was taking some time to think about all this, it's like one feels different than the other. I don't know if maybe one feels like that earned or not, you know? And so I just was grappling with that idea of how power comes to be.
Yeah, and that really resonates, Lisa, and it was kind of in line with what Sammy dropped in the chat is power influences the way in which we choose to wield ours, both personally and professionally. And so kind of thinking about the power that we've gained, the power that we were born into, and how are we using that is such a critical conversation to have. Let's see what else in the chat. Thanks for sharing, Lisa. Melanie, were you wanting to share something?
Sure. Yeah. I was just going to say that in my group, we talked about how infrequent it is that you really sit down and think about like what you're good at and sort of what your strengths are. I think too often we all focus on what we could be doing better. So this was just kind of like a nice grounding exercise for me and the folks in my group had sort of similar reactions.
Thanks, Melanie. Sharon, I see your hand raised. Anything you'd like to share?
Well, it, you know, kind of flows with some of the things others have mentioned, in particular, like the power and privilege. It's certainly true that the two sort of walk hand in hand, if you will. And I think that, and brought this up in the group as well, it's a matter of who has the power is as significant as what the power is. Because, for example, when you're talking about power and privilege, someone had mentioned even our group, well, if I am white and have white privilege, I can use that. I can use that to make myself be heard, i.e. a power for advocacy, for example. But when you're talking about those who have the power and are essentially not using it well, or don't really, if somebody is evil and they've got power, that's where the danger comes, you know, and it becomes a term abuse of power. But it's just, that's kind of why we were saying we had struggles with the breadth of the word, and we came up with that before. So it's just that, that's all. It's sort of cyclical to what was said already. Thank you.
Thank you, Sharon, for that reflection. And again, that need to be really explicit in naming the power so that we can begin to shift it as needed, both within ourselves and the collective. So I really appreciate you all thinking about this activity, engaging with it. And it's something I encourage you to adapt, to use with your teams, because it can be really powerful, using that word again, of seeing where the powers lie within your team and then being intentional and revisiting throughout your programs and initiatives. And it also really bolsters up kind of team morale as we're thinking of our collective superpowers in the space. Awesome. So Eli, we can go to the next activity. We share the screen. There we go. So we've talked about individual power, power over and power with, and you'll hear us talk about community power. And so we wanted to provide a brief definition of, at HRIA, when we say community power, this is what we mean. And this was adapted from the Lead Local initiative. But community power is the ability of historically marginalized communities, most impacted by racism and other oppressive systems, to develop and sustain an organized base of people, including leaders who, can I get a volunteer to read those bullets quickly?
Can act collectively through democratic and other structures to set agendas, shift narratives to uplift power and break down systems that perpetuate inequity, influence who makes decisions, shifting power to those closest to the issues, and cultivates ongoing relationships of shared accountability with decision makers that change systems and advance health equity.
Thank you so much. So a lot of the themes that we had talked about individually, but the acting collectively, uplifting those who may have less power in certain identities. The big thing here is the relationships piece, right? Power, relationship, trust building is central to our work. So that's a lot of words on the page, and we wanted to bring it to life a little bit about some of the strategies we see in the community power building space in our work within HRIA. So on the next slide, Eli, some of the pieces that when we think of community power, and a lot of what I'm sure you all are doing in your work, is that community engagement piece or community organizing. Having community voice in decision-making, which can sometimes be in civic engagement and others, funding, right, which we've talked a lot about is who has the money, who has the power, and also that relationship building, and even things like communication and marketing. All of these can be strategies, and we'll lift a couple of these up in our examples moving forward. But I am curious if folks, as they read this list, are there any other strategies that you may use in your work or can think about as you're thinking about community power building? All right, if not, we'll move forward, but feel free to drop it in the chat if anything comes to mind as you're thinking about community power building. But these are the ones that we use the most within our organization. And just by seeing some of the names in the group, I know that a lot of you are deploying a lot of these strategies as well. So now we're gonna move forward to talking about us and reflecting on HRIA and some of the internal and external examples that we think about as we're lifting up lived experience, leadership buy-in that we wanted to post to the group. And I see some reflections in the chat, intentional facilitation strategies. Yes, Heather, so key. That's a good one and we'll add it to the list. Appreciate that. Okay, so the next slide. Eli, some tactics, some strategies, guidelines, whatever you want to call them, that we really wanted to bring forth in this space, that we want to lift up with some examples, is investing time up front, encouraging the pause. So much of our work is just so fast paced, and there really is a need as we're thinking about power, about intentionally and authentically engaging folks, to invest that time up front to pause, to really take note and an inventory of our power, how we're shifting it, what are our resources, and that can take time, but we really see that as a critical piece that if not embedded in our timelines, our work plans, it can really make the rest of the initiative really run amiss. Defining your influence and recognizing your power in relationship to others. As we were thinking, Valerie and I, throughout this webinar, we were kind of thinking, maybe that's like knowing your lane, not staying in your lane, but knowing where you are in this landscape of systems. And so being able to define that with your team is really important. What we'll focus on today is the internal policies through your hiring, budgeting, 360 reviews. And just really the key takeaway here is that we need to prioritize relationship and trust building, and that a lot of this work really does move at the speed of trust, and we need to be patient with it. The behind the scenes work is so critical as we're thinking about our internal work and as we're working with community residents, coalitions, and that continuous self-reflection really is and needs to take priority. That can look like things like the formation of our teams. Who are we bringing into these spaces? What do our timelines look like? Whose lived experience are we trying to uplift? And then really meeting people where they're at. So I want to offer not one right way to do things. I'm just checking out the chat at the same time. Thank you all for that. Okay, and so I want to bring some examples to some of these high level tactics that we've shared. And the first is using the person role systems framework. So Eli, can we go to the next slide? So really in contemplating how we generate a fresh start and what we may do in our spheres of influence to change the systems and really promote well-being for everyone, we really find this framework helpful. So the person role system framework recognizes the dynamic interplay between the mental viewpoints of people as individuals, and that's that middle circle here, their responsibilities and their personal and professional roles, and the overall impact of their actions on a system. So we use this, and when we're thinking about how do we take time up front and encourage the pause, I would really encourage folks to use this with leadership as you're thinking about the buy-in for your initiative. Even if it's just adding it to an agenda item and taking note of what are the systems that we're working in, what's the role of my organization, and then what am I contributing as an individual to this space? So to give you an example of how that looks in HRIA, we know that our leadership is super busy, just like in all of your organizations, and we're doing a lot of policy level work. Maybe we didn't have buy-in from all of the leadership we needed at the time, and we knew that we needed them in these conversations to really name their role in this space. So we had a couple of strategy sessions, and we worked from the outside in this concentric circle. And we started with the systems. We did a root cause analysis, and some of you may be familiar with the whys, the five whys, but really naming as a team, what are the systems that we're operating in this policy work in Massachusetts? And we spent a whole hour thinking through it, getting to the root causes, and really naming what the systems we're working in look like. Our second strategy meeting focused entirely on that role piece of, what is HRIA's role? What is our leverage and our influence? And we had big post-it notes, and we're just going through what can we add to this systems level work? What is our space? What is our leverage of influence? And finally, our last one was really thinking of ourselves as people. How are we developing our project teams? What's the mix, the best mix of our lived professional and personal experience in this policy work? And then being able to be nimble with each other and flexible and sharing with the group what that looks like. And so using a framework like this and really being intentional with leadership can get some of that buy-in. And it also adds that accountability piece when some of your leaders are saying, this is me as a person. This is what I'm bringing to the work. And then the accountability piece, right, of the role. What is my role formally and informally? And what am I contributing to this system? And so thinking about this framework and how you might adapt it, again, it doesn't need to be a lot of strategy sessions the way that we did, but revisiting it throughout and especially upfront is really key to recognize those dynamic interplays between the mental viewpoints that we're bringing in as people and the responsibility of our professional roles and ultimately how that's impacting our work in the larger system. Let's see the chat. See some great quotes. Thanks, all. I'm loving this section in the chat. So now just to bring it to life a little bit more, I'm gonna hand it over to Valerie to talk about an initiative within HRIA as we're thinking about lived experience of oppression within our staff. So Valerie, I'm gonna hand it over to you.
Thank you, Erica. I really appreciate that grounding in individual and community power and then setting us up with this person role systems framework. So as Erica mentioned, I'm excited to have the opportunity to share with you an example of some internal policy and practice change that we are undergoing at Health Resources in Action. Eli, if you want to go to the next slide. And in line with our one of our key objectives, really focusing on how are we elevating the value of lived experience at HRIA. So I'm going to start us off by offering a definition of lived experience of oppression for you all to take in. If I can actually ask for a volunteer, if someone is willing to unmute themselves and read this out loud, I'd appreciate it.
The lived experience of oppression is the sum of an individual's past events and personal history with navigating systems of power through their marginalized, oppressed identities or backgrounds.
Thanks, Carla. There's a part two to this definition on the next slide, you know, where we think it's important to also lift up, and I saw that someone mentioned it earlier in the chat, the idea of intersectionality and how we have multiple identities that overlap, whether it be race or class or gender, and are interdependent around these systems of discrimination. So we've listed some examples there in no particular order of ways in which lived experience and intersectionality may overlap. So that could include ableism, classism, racism, and this is by no means meant to be an exhaustive list. So this definition, as I mentioned, is a living working definition that was developed by a work group at HRA that I'm going to be telling you more about. But before I do that, we wanted to offer this definition to you all and give you some time to process and digest it a little bit. So we're going to give you some time for individual reflection to think through two questions that are on the next slide. One is just, how familiar are you with the concept of lived experience? Is it new for you? Maybe you're really familiar with it. And then secondly, how do your lived experiences inform your work? And so we're gonna drop a link to a Padlet. If you want to click on that link, you can offer your reflections anonymously there. You're also welcome to share your reflections in the chat. And so we'll just take about maybe 4 minutes for you all to sort of take that definition in, because I know it's a lot of words on a slide. And so Eli, if you can, and feel free to turn off your camera, again, use the Padlet or use the chat, and then we'll come back at about 11:30. Thanks all.
Would you mind putting the definition back up? Thanks.
Thanks, Eli. Jasper also dropped the definition in the chat too. One more minute to wrap up. Add anything to the Padlet? Bring everyone back to this space. Thank you so much for sharing your reflections. I really appreciate what I'm seeing here. So just to lift up some of what I'm seeing, it sounds like some of you are very familiar with the concept, either through personal or professional experiences. I think there are certain spaces and types of work where I think the term or concept of lived experience has been lifted up for a while now. I even think of our own organization. We have a substance use helpline, and our team of substance use helpline staff, they have been talking about the importance of lived experience for quite some time, as you know, they have staff who have been in recovery, for example. And then I also really appreciate how you all have shared examples of how either your own lived experience is informing your work, or I saw someone's vulnerability and sort of the, which is very real, like the hesitation to bring forth one's lived experience in their work, which I can relate to as well. And I think it speaks to the importance of normalizing it as something that we can talk about openly to the extent that we're comfortable. And so I'm going to be talking a little bit about that as we move forward in our conversation. So thank you for that. Okay. So I want to share a little bit about how we got to this definition, lifting up the efforts of our lived experience work group. And so Eli, if you can share the slides again on slide 29. So this is a staff-driven effort at HRIA. The goal of the lived experience work group is to expand HRIA's pay factors. So HRIA has a set of pay factors that are probably pretty familiar, you know, your sort of more traditional pay factors like years of work experience or education level. And about, I think I wanna say 2 years ago now, across the organization, staff recognized that lived experience was glaringly missing from our list of pay factors. And while HRIA maybe implicitly has valued lived experience, that it was really important to be explicit in recognizing and honoring staff who are using and applying their lived experience on a daily basis to advance and benefit the work of our organization. And so the approach that the lived experience work group took was really threefold that you can see laid out here. First and foremost, starting by developing a shared language. And that's where this definition that we shared with you all came about. That was really a collaborative and iterative effort by work group members, a labor of love, I would say. And it's a living definition. And I think by starting at this place then gave us some of the language that we needed to start talking about it more openly and honestly. And then with that came, you know, I saw that a lot of you are very familiar with this term. I think at HRIA, it really varied across the organization with how familiar staff were with the term. And so making sure that the work group really focused on increasing understanding and awareness of lived experience so that people were in a place where they were ready to start implementing or operationalizing policies. And then last but not least, and I mentioned this already, but this was a staff-driven effort. And so these were, there are a set of staff-driven solutions that are being identified and recommended to leadership. And so I'm going to share just a couple of examples of ways in which we are integrating lived experience at HRIA, recognizing that there are more that we are working on. And so the first one I want to lift up that I would say was actually in place in some cases prior to the lived experience work group. And so that is on the next slide, you can see in the space of recruitment and hiring. So I mentioned the substance use helpline as one example that for decades has been listing, for example, lived experience on job descriptions under candidate qualifications. But it goes beyond our substance use helpline to other departments as well, really making space to show that hopefully candidates, to the extent they are comfortable, feel like they can bring their lived experience forward as something that is valued at HRIA. And then secondly, in our interview questions, whether it be through screening someone on the phone initially, or when we do our one-on-one sort of group interviews, posing questions that again, it's not a requirement. We by no means want to force someone to share their lived experience if they're not comfortable, but creates a space or an invitation to share their lived experience. And so these are just a couple of examples of the types of questions that we include in our interviews, such as, you know, please talk about your lived or learned experiences working across identities, or what lived or learned experience would you bring to this role? And I think importantly, something that I learned from our substance use helpline
staff is when they are doing interviews and they're going around and doing staff introductions, they also share their lived experience as part of their introduction, which I think further serves to sort of create a space or an invitation for job applicants to feel comfortable, if they wish, to share their lived experience. Again, not a requirement by any means, but a space there. And so, and the other thing I want to add actually on this note, which is related, is something, another practice that we have implemented or began to implement is sharing interview questions in advance. By no means do we want these questions to be a surprise to candidates where they're feeling like they need to respond to it in the moment. So we do send out our questions prior to the interview so that candidates have time and space to prepare. And we see this as another way of advancing a more equitable interview process. Okay, and then the other way, and this is sort of newer, that we are integrating lived experience is through our annual performance reviews. And this is very fresh in my mind, is because HRA just went through our annual performance review process. And so an optional section was added to our performance reviews so that if staff chose, again, it's choice, they could share how their lived experiences support their work at HRIA. And the specific question is, how do your unique lived experiences, marginalized identities or experiences that you bring, inform and enhance your work at HRIA? And so examples could include ways in which they might build trust with or engage communities or your own team members based on shared identities, having the unique perspective to make materials more accessible to specific populations with whom you share an identity, and other sort of cultural and experiential insights. So this is the first time we're doing this. It's a pilot and we look forward to learning from it. We are planning to evaluate sort of and see what we learn from this process, but a super exciting initiative that, as I mentioned, has been led by our lived experience work group. And in a little bit, I am going to invite a colleague of mine to talk through some ways in which the lived experience work group, I think, has done an exceptional job of shifting power. But before we do that, I just shared a lot of information with you. And I would love to hear more about, there's a couple of questions for you all to consider. One, on the next slide, how are you centering those with lived experience in your work? And two, what successes or challenges have you encountered? So similar to the process we've been taking, we'll give you some space for some individual reflection to jot down some thoughts with a pen and paper, and then we'll be going into small groups so that you can share with each other, again, how you're centering those with lived experience in your work and what's working and what's not. And we really look forward to hearing what you all talk about. Any questions before we go into individual reflection?
I had put one in the chat, which is just that sometimes I think in workplaces we're kind of told that we can't, or interviews, that we can't share, we can't like ask about certain lived experience because it could be used as a basis for discrimination or our own bias around like, oh, they have, you know, triplets at home, that's not going to bode well, you know?
Mm-hmm. Yeah. No, you're actually right that, for example, it's illegal to ask specific questions. But I think that, you know, that ask, like to your example, like, are you a parent or are you in recovery? Yeah, that is not legal for sure. I want to be clear on that. But I think our intention with these broad open-ended questions and by framing it as what lived or learned experience, right, it's really what the individual wants to share. So I think that's an important distinction.
Yeah, thanks.
Sharon, you have your hand raised.
Well, The slides referred to it in the last part of your answer, so either lived or learned. Some of the slides had lived or learned. Some are specific to lived experience. How do you qualify? Are they meant to be the same thing or qualified differently? In other words, for lived experience, I may not be part of a marginalized group, but I have I have learned experience because of actually being maybe the black sheep in a very prejudiced family who speaks up or something like that, you know?
Right.
So how are you defining them in terms of separate entities versus both the same?
Yeah, that's a great question. They are distinct. And the reason we combine them is learned experience is sort of a more casual way of saying like professional work experience. And the reason that we combine the two is, again, so that the candidate or the individual feels like they have a choice and doesn't feel forced. So, for example, if the question were, what lived experience do you bring to this role? That to me is placing the individual in an uncomfortable position because they may not want to share. And so by broadening it and inviting them to share either their lived or professional or both, you're, again, I think a lot of this is about placing the choice and the power with the individual. So that's the intention behind that framing. Thank you for these questions. Again, more to come. But why don't we do 3 minutes for individual reflection, and then we'll go into small groups. Okay, welcome back, everyone. I hope that was useful to hear from your colleagues and maybe get some ideas about ways that you could center those with lived experience in your work. I see that Tyshawn, you have your hand raised. Go ahead.
Great. I'll try to be as brief as possible. When I was listening before we went out to breakout groups, and there was a lot of questions surrounding like why ask these type of questions surrounding lived experience and learned experience and what have you. And then I was thinking to myself, I think that, you know, one of the things that's important to really note is how did we get here, right? How did HRIA get to the point where they want to even begin to ask these questions surrounding lived experience? What was the history? Where are we at now? I think in my personal opinion, I think that when doing any type of human service work, I think that lived experience and wanting to incorporate and utilize people with lived experience is just common sense. It's just socially, people just gravitate towards that, more towards people that they identify with. And also, when we're talking about workers in the field have lived experience, bring forth a different type of empathy. They bring forth a different type of understanding and a different type of drive. And so they, you know, something to prove in their work. If y'all know me, I gotta slow down, and that's why y'all get those pauses, because I be wanting to go, but I'm gonna land the plane and stop right there.
Tyshawn, I appreciate you. Thank you so much for lifting up those points. The history is incredibly important, and I do, as I mentioned, our substance use helpline has been explicitly, I think, talking about lived experience as it relates to their work for decades. I think what's new for HRIA is to be explicit about it in a consistent way across the organization, across all of our teams and departments. To your point, Tyshawn, when I joined and interviewed for my position at HRIA 12 years ago, I shared the question was not asked of me, but I shared my identities and lived experiences as part of that interview because I thought it was important. So anyway, just agree with everything that you said. Just want to echo that. Thank you so much for sharing.
Yeah, and just briefly once again, and then there's the idea of as being a healthcare professional in this industry, it's the idea of the kind of like the feedback loop from that and sharing your lived experience, in which people don't want to share that lived experience because they're afraid of that being kind of against them. Mm-hmm. But at the same time, from and this is a personal perspective, right? Where individuals begin to understand that when sharing your lived experience is like having the need to be brave. That there, that although you might not get that higher job because you did step out and share your lived experience, and the hierarchy didn't receive you well, we have a tendency to say, "Well, I shouldn't have done that. I shouldn't have shared my lived experience." Now they're holding against me, and then we get upset and build resentments. But understanding that there are consequences for being brave, and sometimes those consequences aren't the consequences that we that live up to our expectations. So we have to not only share our lived experience in the workplace, but also be resilient. And
thank you so much. And that's one of the reasons why I think we wanted to lift up the efforts of the lived experience work group, because something that I've observed is what they are doing is like normalizing, making it more common for people to share and talk about their lived experience. And in a moment, I'm going to invite Jasper Lee to talk a little bit more about that. Before I do, I want to briefly introduce a tool that may be familiar to some of you. And so, Eli, if I can ask you to share the screen again. We're going to go over a power mapping tool. And just so you know, after the break, a little bit later, you'll have a chance to actually try it on and apply it to your own work. So to walk through this at a high level, as you can see, this is a 2x2 grid. And it's an opportunity to take a step back and pause and assess who you need to engage in how to achieve change. And so you're examining where you might have high support for a potential change, whether it be in your organization or the community versus low support, and also where there is high or low authority for decision-making. And so it's really important to identify folks that are high support and high influence early on in your efforts, because you know that you have their buy-in from the get-go, and think about what role they can play in helping to move those who might be low support and high influence along the trajectory. And so because those who have the high authority but maybe low support are the ones that might need the most time and effort on the front end to have them support your initiative for change. And so this tool on slide 34, which you'll be using in a little bit, will give you a chance to think about who might be falling into each of these quadrants, basically, whether they're low interest, they don't have a lot of interest, but they have a lot of influence in your organization, for example, or if they have low influence, but high interest, and they're all important in the process too. I don't want to diminish that just because someone might have low influence that they shouldn't be engaged. And then once you've done that, it's thinking through, okay, now you know where all the stakeholders lie within this power map. Think about whose interests you need to increase and how you might engage them, and whose influence or power you may want to build. This is the next slide. And then also whose narratives are critical to amplify or shift. And so with that, I'm going to invite Jasper Lee, my colleague from HRA, to join us. I mean, Jasper Lee's been with us, but invite them to speak into the space, to share their perspective and their experience as someone who has been a lead organizer of our lived experience work group.
And so just, you know, Jasper and I are basically going to have a conversation. This has not been rehearsed. We're going to be walking through the power mapping tool using the lived experience work group as an example. And yeah, Jasper, I would love for you to introduce yourself though, before I dive in with some questions.
Yeah, happy to. Thanks, Val. Hi, folks. So my name's Jasper Lee. I use they, them, or no pronouns. And I'm actually also a member of our CHTI team, but unfortunately I had to join you all a little bit late this morning, so I probably missed when our whole team was sort of doing their intros. But I'm also the sort of the founder and one of the main lead organizers of the lived experience work group. So I kind of sit nicely at this Venn diagram of what we're talking about here today. And I also share and hold lived experience as a queer person, a trans person, a person of color, you know, being neurodivergent. So a lot of the feedback you all were kind of providing in the chat as well was just super heartwarming for me to see that this also sort of resonates with you all and where you're coming from. So yeah, happy to follow your lead, Val. whatever questions you have of me.
Yeah, thanks, Jasper. And Eli, we can stop screen sharing so that folks can just kind of see us in conversation. And so Jasper, something I've been reflecting on even through this training session is, you know, when Erica shared the community power building definition, I had this takeaway that's really what the lived experience work group has been doing, is like shifting and building power among marginalized staff at HRA, those who are most impacted by systems of oppression. And I was reading and I was like, this is what the lived experience work group did, right? Like acting collectively, shifting narratives, influencing who makes decisions, and shifting power to those who are most impacted. And really, I think I've appreciated how you've really cultivated a lot of relationships with the organization for shared accountability and decision-making. So with that, why don't we start with, if you could share a little bit about, you know, thinking about that 4x4 grid, who did the work group engage along the way? Sort of thinking about where they fall in terms of their level of interest or influence.
Yeah, I think that's a great question. And it's one that actually was, because as I was looking at the slides, right, I never looked at or used sort of this power mapping grid over the course of organizing the work group, but I can see now how this, I think, was a really helpful framework and maybe we should have. But I do think, so very, very early on, as I was beginning, I think, some of these conversations with folks just before we even had a work group, right? So sort of that pre-work of trying to identify who is interested and who is being impacted. I sort of started with two main groups of people. And I think that there's high interest, right? And kind of both, but differing levels of power. So thinking about maybe that right half of the grid of high interest, but differing levels of power and influence. Two main groups of people, right? So it was colleagues who I was in community with, right? So other sort of lower level staff in the organization, BIPOC staff, gender minorities, other queer folks, neurodivergent folks, like just folks who I, you know, bumped into doing the work and was like, wow, I'm with you, right? As well as sort of organizational leadership, right? So whether that kind of be the leaders in maybe some of the different sort of optional committees, right? The E&I committee, Equity and Inclusion committee, the staff engagement committee, as well as senior leadership, right? So I had, I kind of shot an email off to our COO and, you know, the head of our HR, and spoke to Steve, who's our president and CEO. And right, just all of these different folks who kind of, I think, were really engaged in different parts of the conversation, but coming at it from different perspectives. And so that kind of happened at the same time as we sort of tried to figure out where this work group might live. And so just lots of high interest folks at first. And I think later on, as the work group kind of shifted, thinking about the other quadrants, so lots of power, but maybe low interest, and sort of the low interest, low power or low influence quadrant. I think we've been trying to move in that direction lately of trying to figure out how to engage those folks as well, right? So I'll pause there. I don't know if that was helpful. or the answer to your question that you were looking for.
Yeah, that was super helpful. So thinking about, there were some initial, at the organizational leadership level, there were some leaders who had high interest and high influence that you engaged early on, as well as staff who had high interest and maybe lower influence. But I don't want to discount that, in that I think it's important, something we've been talking about throughout, is everyone has power, no matter where you are in the organization. And I think next it would be helpful to talk through how you went about engaging stakeholders along the way. And I, just in the interest of time, I think it might be helpful to focus on what would be the more challenging group, potentially. So I don't know if you agree, but I would tend to think it might be the high influence, low interest group, but I defer to you. What were some of the maybe more challenging groups to engage, and how are you working on engaging them along the way?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I think, so at least one pragmatic tool that I do want to recommend, I think, to folks in the training that I've found to be so powerful, as we think about sort of this community building, community power, way of doing like work just in general, is the power of one-on-ones, the power of one-on-one meetings. So pretty much almost everybody, I think, in the work group, I've actually had a one-on-one meeting with, at least an hour with, right? Just to chat, get to know them, and understand and kind of make connections of like, wow, I really see like, this is why you feel called to this work. This is why I feel called to this work, right? And we come together, and that really helps us feel, I think, united and aligned. And part of that is, I think, right, not just with folks who have multiply marginalized identities, right, folks I'm in community with, but also I think is a really valuable tool when looking at some of these higher, leadership or folks who have some of that higher institutional power, right? Especially I think for those maybe low interest folks, like who are maybe, I think, have maybe a lot of personal power and privilege, and so maybe don't quite see maybe that alignment of like why we're trying to do this, right? This is an equity measure, right? This is really looking at how to do kind of reparations, right? When we're thinking about supporting staff who have this lived experience of oppression, who have gone through, in a lot of cases, a lot more challenge to get to where they are now versus other folks. And so I think the power of one-on-ones is a really powerful tool. And not neglecting, I think, that personal, interpersonal attention and component, right? We had a lived experience work group meeting earlier this week, actually yesterday.
Ishmael?
And I actually reached out to a lot of folks privately and messaged them and said, hey, I actually haven't seen if you've RSVP'd to this event or not. Like, can I see you there? Like, will you be there? You'll be missed. If not, right? And thinking about ways for folks who couldn't make it that they could engage asynchronously or outside of that meeting space, whether it's through email or Padlets or whatnot, to make that more accessible for folks as well. But just, you know, I think showing up and being invested in one another, regardless of where you are, I think kind of in that maybe interest spectrum, but I think it's a really, really key sort of strategy I want folks to kind of take with and run with.
Awesome. Thank you so much, Jasper, for those insights in your process. And I can see that Christine giving support for that asynchronous communication. Maybe it's just like a last question, although never enough time. Any other lessons learned that you might share with the group? If there's like someone else in this space who's interested in, you know, doing something similar at their organization, any other tips that you might have to share?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I think, everybody has the skills to be able to do this kind of work, right? Thinking back to that power wheel that you all shared, right? Thinking about like that personal power. If this kind of work really speaks to you, I can pretty much guarantee you already have the skill set to be able to engage with this work or start this work, right? Because it really is as simple as setting up, like this is what I did very early on in the beginning and still try to do continually now. It's as simple as setting up like a lunch call with a coworker who you're close with and saying, hey, I just want to like catch up and chat. Or maybe you don't know this person well and you just want to get to know them. People respond really well to just, I think, that friendliness and that kind of intention to get to know them and see what commonality you have. And that's really the backbone of a lot of this work, right, is the community building piece, right? We can't go forth and do this kind of work if we're not all united in understanding what our shared values are, right? I mean, we really guided the work group, I think, the first year of our work by bringing up constantly our shared values of transparency, accountability, and equity, right? And being very clear that our leadership was going to be sort of centered around the folks who were the most impacted and the folks who have sort of the most lived experience of oppression, right? Because that solution has to be written and determined by them. And so I think when in doubt, reach out, grab lunch with someone, talk about your values. You know, you have to go slow to go fast. So you have to do that sort of building work first before you can really start to engage in like accelerating some of this equity work.
Thanks, Jasper. And I think starting with those sort of high interest, high influence folks as you did is a great place to start as well. So I'm keeping an eye on the time. You're right, Jasper. We were talking how we probably could have spent the entire 3 hours on this topic alone. but with that, I'm also recognizing that we've been going quite long without a break. And so I think we all want to give you time for a breather to refill your drinks or your snacks. And then we will come back at, I guess, to make it an even time, come back at 12:30. That sound good? So we will see you all back here in 10 minutes. Thanks all.
Decision making and also the outside with organizers, community movements and community groups who are trying to apply that pressure where governments and formal decision makers may not be interested. So in the next two sections, Eli, if you go to the next one, this is in the city of Chelsea. And this is an example of we worked with inside the government where we talked to the town manager and we used our influence as HRIA with deep standing relationships in this community. We went to the town manager and said, listen, you have this big pot of money. How are you planning to spend it? What are those equitable outcomes you're trying to reach? And how are you engaging those closest to the pain in the solutions, like our Congresswoman Ayanna Pressley always says? And so through that influence and working inside government structures, the town management agreed to hold a chunk of their ARPA dollars, something like $10 million, to a community-led process. And a lot of that was by pushing on the inside, building that collective understanding and that awareness with our reputation in the community and with that formal decision makers. And we facilitated a six-month process with 20 residents who reflected the city of Chelsea, young people, small business owners, those whose English wasn't their first language. And we had them really go through this voting process that was intense. And that's that the checkers on the right-hand side of this photo, where community residents actually had that power in their hands and they decided where their ARPA dollars were going. And we used our influence on the inside to really push government to that accountability piece that this is something that could and should be doing with their ARPA dollars. Next slide, Eli. Now on the outside, for those of you familiar with Massachusetts, Everett has a really strong organizing base and they have some challenges that are unique to their part of the state in terms of historical kind of issues of discrimination and oppression and how their residents are really pushing to that accountability piece and in identifying and applying pressure where needed. So this is an example of how we worked on the outside. Again, the topic was still the ARPA dollars, but this coalition came to us and said, you know what? We know what we need to do, how we need to apply pressure. We need you to show up in these ways. And sometimes that meant showing up to city council meetings. Eli, if you want to go to the next slide. There's one of our directors, Ben Wood, sitting at a city council meeting testifying about how we see as public health professionals, how these dollars should be used and how residents should be engaged. So again, that's showing up people power, and really listening to what the coalition needed. That also meant they asked us, hey, we need help and support in building, practicing when we go to this city council meeting with our young people. Can you help us create an agenda, or can you help us run the tech so that we can practice with each other? Other things that we've been asked to do are create tools or templates for them in terms of best practices. So we're working completely on the outside of government here, knowing that we need both that inside and that outside pressure for transformational and societal change. And this can be applied to your work in a lot of different ways. Maybe you're not working in the political sphere or policy change world, but all of us do have that inside collective understanding of what needs to happen within our organization, within our spheres of influence, and also on the outside as we're thinking of who might be our opponents or the opposition and what we're trying to work with, and how are we using both of these inside-outside strategies to push forward that message of power with power being infinite. So I know I ran through that because I want us to start thinking about these tools a little bit more intently. But if you have any questions related to that inside, outside, or our ARPA work, we'll be sure to link to it and you can reach out to Valerie or I, and we'd be happy to connect. So Eli, you wanna go to our next piece? We wanted to leave you in our last 20 minutes with just trying some of these tools on. And so Jasper was able to talk through some of their thinking with the lived experience of oppression internally and how that kind of played about. And we think that the really practical tool of power mapping and actor mapping is critical up front in any initiative that you're doing. So we're gonna ask you, we're gonna stay low tech, and we're gonna ask you to just try on these two tools in our last 20 minutes of starting to think of an initiative that you are working on within your job, personally, within your community, and start mapping those actors and that power that we've talked about throughout this webinar on a 2x2 grid. So Eli, can we share? There we go. Yeah, sorry, my screen wasn't up. So you'll spend some time doing that. And it can be in a variety of issues that you're thinking about or working on, work-related or not work-related. And then when you're ready and you've named a few people, it doesn't have to be a huge list. We're going to ask you to transition to that cultivating influence and interest table, which is on the next slide, of really naming whose interests do you want to foster and then how might you engage them. Jasper used a great example of those one-on-ones being a powerful tool, something like, you know, a coffee break or just a chat, but really trying to start mapping those out of whose influence do you need to build. And then thinking about this lived experience piece, whose narratives are really critical and amplified to shift or lift up in this work. And so we hope that this tool is really just a first start as you're thinking of your programmatic work, as your advocacy work, or in your coalition work. So we'll do that for the next, 10, 15 minutes. How does that sound, Eli? All right, folks. So this is your quiet time. You can turn off your camera, but we're gonna kick it old school for a little bit. Use a pen and paper and just start mapping those pieces out. If you have any questions, feel free to drop them in the chat. And if one is calling you more, if you wanna stay on actor mapping for the full 10, 12 minutes in this space, go ahead. Or if you wanna stay in that cultivating influence and interest table, feel free to do that too. We just want this to be a helpful tool to take back to your work. Like, can we get some music on your popular playlist?
going with it, I'm going with it.
Yo, is it? Are you kidding me?
To us, yeah. So we are coming in with a force, yeah. Blessings we are reaping, we coursing on full. Oh, in a rise and boast. Yeah, we give thanks like we need it the most. We have to give thanks like we really supposed to be thankful. Blessings all for my life and my thank God for the journey, the earnings are just for the plus.
Yeah, yeah.
Gratitude is a must. Yeah, we see blessings fall by my right hand. Bust a toast for the friends, we take off every load. One time, did sit down in a class and we ported. Only set the road and we go on with the road. Third form, me say, let me try a thing. And you know it formed out to be a fire thing. Now up on stage with chronic, say, I sing. Yeah, see me all diggy soon, get the higher ring. Like, hello, bro, time, say, I had to shout ya. Saw your poster, spectacular photo. Keep it burning, yes, that's the motto. If me the butter, pass through your shot to get ball in a life, man. Me have to thank God for the journey, the earnings are just for the plus. Yeah, and gratitude is a must. Yeah, me see blessings fall. And send me to tell you my story. That's how all blessings upon me. And that's how I'm gonna give him the glory. I'm delighted. Jah knows my passion ignited. Got the music, get me excited. I'm coming like a potion. Mm-hmm. Blessings all for my life and my thank God for the journey. The earnings are just for the plus. Yeah. And gratitude is a must. Yeah, me see blessings fall by my right hand. Bust a toast for the friends with the life on. My thank God for the journey, the earnings are just for the plus. Yeah. And gratitude is a must. Yeah, me see blessings fall by my right hand. Bust a toast for the friends, we take off every load. One time did sit down in a class and we both dead. Only said the road and we go on with the road. Toast.
Yeah.
Toast.
Turn your low energy into big fitness energy in 2020.
And calculated promises all in your conversations. I hate people that feel entitled. Look at me crazy cause I ain't invite you. Oh, you important, you the moral to the story. You endorsing motherfucker, I don't even like you. Corrupt a man's heart with a gift. That's how you find out who you're dealing with. A smart percentage you I'm building with. I want the credit if I'm losing or I'm winning. Oh, my mama, that's the realest shit.
Let's talk about love. I'm gonna feel it on you.
got no reason, got to stay down. It's the way that you're making me feel like nobody ever loved me, like you do, you do. And you kind of feel like you're trying to get away from me. If you do, I won't move. I ain't just cry for no reason. I ain't just pray for no reason.
Maybe can we start wrapping this section up? All right, folks, I know that was just a brief amount of time, and this is just, you know, we're sharing tools for you to try on and hopefully tape back, sit with, do with your team as needed. And we just wanted to try this on for you so that you can take back some questions and thoughts to your work. So I'm going to hand it over to you, Valerie, and Lauren for some closing thoughts.
Thanks, Erica. And thank you all for your engagement and participation over the past 3 hours or so. I've learned a lot from your engagement. You know, as Erica mentioned, we have shared some tools and ideas for you to try on. I think you all have also offered some ideas for us to consider. We really appreciate it. And we hope that through this session, we have showed you how we can all elevate the value of lived experience and build community power to advance equity. Our contact information is on the very last slide, and it really is an open invitation to reach out to us with any questions or thoughts. Last but not least, I want to lift up a resource that a participant shared with us. I'm going to drop it in the chat around inclusive accommodations. And I wasn't familiar with it, so I appreciate them sharing it while I was looking at it. It's specific to attention deficit hyperactivity disorder. But when I was looking at the strategies that are offered, one thing that was my takeaway was, like, you know, inclusive accommodations really can benefit us all, whether or not we have disabilities. So wanted to offer that resource out for all of you. And with that, I'm going to pass it to Lauren to close us out.
Yes. Thank you, Val. Thank you, Erica. That was an amazing training. So big spirit fingers and emojis and reactions to you all. And I want to thank each and every one of you for attending this training with us today. Hopefully you got a lot out of it. And a big thanks to those of you who did update your coalition entry on our website during our session today. So that is fantastic. I just want to draw your attention to our next training that the Community Health Training Institute will be putting on February 15th. Actually dropping the registration form in the chat. It's on building brave spaces across difference, being facilitated by our very own Jasper Lee and another HRIA colleague, Gracie Rolfe. So before you go, Eli is going to drop our post survey, our feedback survey into the chat. We do ask that you please take that survey. We do look at every single bit of data that you share with us. We compile it and share it back with the Department of Public Health, which helps us continue to get the funding that we need to make these trainings possible. So that is all for us today. Thank you all. Thanks for the love in the chat. Enjoy the rest of your day.